Hey guys, and welcome back to You Nico Dev. Today I will show you how to implement a simple backpropagation neural network in C# using Unity. Now this tutorial will be as beginner friendly as possible, so in order to watch this you just need to know the basics about what a neural network is. And if you don't know even that, like you're completely new to neural networks, there is a small video in the description of this one that will basically teach you the everything you need to know in order to understand this video. Just watch that, I made it a few days ago, and then come back here and you can pick up where you left off and, you know, we can keep going. Oh, and before starting, I just wanted to say, if you're one of those guys that just want the code and don't want to watch the video, everything is in the description, okay? It's just one class, download it, and bam, you have already all of the code. Goodbye. Now, before going, I will actually show you the network in action, and if you already saw the video that is linked in the description, the one I just talked about, you already know what this is, but basically this is an input plane, okay? And the x-axis is our first input, the y-axis is our second input, and I can place any point right here that could be either a red or a blue point, and my network will be able to train on that data and actually classify the point. So as you can see, he got this kind of line that divides my two data, my red and blue data, and I can add as much data as I want and it will be able to compensate. Now naturally, as the network gets more complicated, so we have more hidden layers, it will be able to do more complex curves and it will be able to better classify more complex data. So let me just pump this up a little bit, and as you can see, it's working. Alright, so I want to keep this as simple as possible, so we're gonna fit all of the code in one class. It's actually not a lot of code that does the neural network stuff work. And right here, I have the code already completed, so as you can see, this is a little bit of a spoiler of the end of the video. This is all the code we're gonna build up in this episode. I know this may look scary, but don't worry, it's actually surprisingly simple, and you know, once you actually just know the basics about how this works, it's gonna be fairly simple to implement in any language. The reason I'm doing this in C# is because I saw there is a little bit of a lack of tutorials, of coding tutorials, done specifically for this language. And also I'm using C#, so I can then mess around with Unity and actually create something cool, maybe a game, and I could make the network train it. So that's pretty fun for future episodes. Anyway, this is the class we're gonna be working on right here. And before starting, I will just make it serializable, just for the time being, okay? This will be useful later when we want to save or load our networks, but we're not gonna talk about network storage in this episode. Alright, so first of all, let's set up some variables. Okay, so first of all, we need a two-dimensional vector, which is gonna describe our nodes, and more specifically, the values of our nodes. Remember, every node holds a number that goes, in our example, from 0 to 1. The first dimension of the vector will be the layer the node is in, and the second dimension of the vector will be the number of the node that goes from 0 to whichever is the last node of that layer. We cannot do the same thing for the biases. Remember, every node has a value and a bias. And then we're gonna do a sort of a similar thing for weights. Now it's gonna actually be a three-dimensional vector for weights. Basically, the first dimension will still describe the layer, but now the second dimension will describe on what node the weight is connected to, and the third one will describe on what node the weight is connected from. Alright, so don't worry about my perfect drawing skills, but let's pretend we have a network that is set up in this way. Now, if we want to examine this connection in our array, in our vector array, will be basically like this. The connection starts on layer 1, because this is layer 0, this is layer 1, and this is layer 2, so it starts on layer 1. Then we need to see on what node the connection goes to. So this is node 0, this is node 1, 2, and 3. So our second number will be 3. And then we need to see at what node the connection originates from. And this is node 0, and this is node 1. So our third number will be 1. So in this way, we can represent all possible connections and all possible weights affiliated with those connections. Alright, so from now on, there are three things that are left to do. First of all, we need to initialize all of these values, and we're gonna do this in the constructor. Then we're gonna work on this function right here, which is basically just gonna test the inputs, meaning we give the network some inputs, and it will give us back some outputs. And then the third function, which is the one you're probably all here for, is actually the training function, where we give our network some inputs, we also give our network some outputs, which we know are already correct, and the network will be able to train on those inputs and outputs, and actually improve. Alright, let's begin with part 1, which is actually the initialization. Alright, before moving on to our next part, we actually need 3 more variables, which are similar to these. And I'm gonna call these desired values. This one is gonna be biases smudge, and this one is gonna be weights smudge. Basically, when we train our network, we're gonna have to keep track on how much we need to smudge the different biases and weights and even desired values, the values that we want to calculate, the values we know are correct. So it's good to keep track of them in these variables, but we're gonna get into them later when we work on training. Now though, we need to initialize them. Our constructor will take as a parameter an array of integer, which is gonna be the structure of our network. The way this is gonna work is simple. We're basically telling this class how many layers our network is going to have, and how many nodes per layers our network is gonna have. If our structure is like this, it means that our network is gonna have one input layer with 2 nodes, one output layer with 2 nodes, and one hidden layer with 3 nodes. But naturally, we can add as many hidden layers as we want to this. But for this example, we're probably only gonna use a one hidden layer network. And we already know that the first dimension of all of these values is the number of layers, and this array size is gonna be the number of layers our network has. So in the case we were doing before, we have one input, one output, and one hidden layer, so this number is gonna come out to be 3. Now just one exception to the rule is gonna be the weights and the weights smudge. The weights and the weights smudge actually have to be one shorter of that, and the reason why that is, if you can just draw all of these nodes again, but yeah, the reason why that is because the connection can start from layer 0, for example, it can also start from layer 1, but there can be no connection that can start from the output layer, because there is just nothing to connect to, this is the last layer. So the connection table can actually be one shorter, because the connections cannot connect from the outputs, that wouldn't make any sense. Alright, so now we have to iterate for every layer, and we actually have to check how many nodes that layer has, and actually initialize our array accordingly. So right here we are initializing our values and biases first. Basically what we are doing is iterating through every layer, so structure.length, and we are taking the structure, structure I, which means the number of nodes in that specific layer, and we are setting the values to an array of that size. This makes sense. Now this actually can be a read-only list. Okay, cool. So it just updated the type. Alright, and now all that is left to do is initialize the weights. Now we need to iterate over the layers one more time, but this time we need to iterate one less, because as I said before, the last layer, the outputs, doesn't have any connections, or doesn't have any connection that originate from it. Okay, so we said that the first dimension of our connection is gonna be the layer it stands on. The second dimension is going to be where the connection connects to, at which node the connection connects to. So naturally the size of this vector, of this dimension, is gonna be the number of nodes we have on our next layer. So if we are starting the connection from here, for example, it can connect to 3 different places. So the number of the second dimension, the size of the second dimension, is gonna always be the size of the next layer. And this is exactly what we've written right here. And then we're gonna iterate one more time, but this time over our second dimension of the vector, so we can initialize the third dimension, both for the weights and the weights smudge. And as you know, the third dimension is where the connection can originate from, so naturally the size of this dimension, this time, will actually be the size of the layer the connection starts from. Because the connection can originate from, you know, in this case, 2 different nodes, because the layer where it stands on is composed of 2 different nodes. So as you can see, our third dimension size will be the size of the layer the connection actually stays in. So this way we initialized all of our weights. Now the only problem is that our weights now are initialized at 0, and we don't want that. Initializing weights at 0 is actually pretty bad for learning. You should actually initialize them randomly. So we're gonna iterate over every weight, just like this, and do this, okay? So this is every single weight. We are iterating over every single weight. We're actually gonna initialize them. We're gonna create a new system.random, and we're gonna do random.nextDouble, which basically is a number from 0 to 1. Okay, let's convert this into a float. Okay, there is actually a good practice when initializing weights, and it's this formula right here. Now, we don't need to go in depth about on why this is the formula, but it has actually been proven that if you initialize your weights by a random number that goes from 0 to 1, and then you multiply that number by the square root of 2 divided the number of nodes in the layer that comes after the connection, so in this case it would be 3, you actually get a far better result. And this actually helps with the problem of vanishing gradients and a bunch of other stuff we're not gonna discuss in this video, but will be really interesting to discuss in further videos in this series. But for now, let's just shrug it off and just do this. Okay, good, we are officially done with the initialization. Now let's go on and actually make our network work. And I have written some pseudocode which is gonna help us through this. So the first thing we need to do is set the inputs. So the input layer is always the first layer. So what we can do is just iterate over the first layer of our nodes. So we're just gonna do a for loop and iterate over our values, which is basically our nodes, dot length. So we're gonna iterate over every node in the first layer. And we're gonna set every one of these nodes, which are gonna be our inputs, to the inputs that are actually the parameter of this function. So this way, we are basically just setting the inputs to our network. Alright, so now it's time to iterate over every node. We are first gonna iterate over every layer, and then inside of here, we will also iterate over every node. Okay, perfect, and we're gonna calculate the value of every node. If you saw the introduction video, that is in the description, you know how to calculate the value of a node. For example, if we want to calculate the value of this node, we have to take the value of the nodes it's connected to, which are gonna be this one and this one. You can pretend there is a connection here. So we're gonna take the value of the first node and multiply it by the weight of the connection, plus the value of the second node, multiply it by the weight of the second connection, plus the bias of the node we want to calculate. Okay, great, we have all of the information, we just have to write it in code. To make this actually easier, I have written a sum function, and basically what this will do, it will take two lists, okay? The first list will be the values, and the second list will be the weights, and it will iterate over every value, which is every node in a given layer, and will multiply the value by the corresponding weight. And then, after it did all of this multiplication over every single node, it will actually sum that up. So basically, this sums up to the formula v1 multiplied by w1 plus v2 multiplied by w2, etc. Alright, so we can just use this formula. So the value of the node we want to calculate is gonna be equal to the sum of all of the values of the last layer and all of the connections of the last layer which actually connect to the node we want to calculate. So here we're gonna put a j. And after we have done this function, we need to add the bias. So we're just gonna add the bias of the node we want to calculate. Great. Now we need to normalize this output, and we need to do that with a squishification function. In our case, we're gonna use the sigmoid function. So I'm just gonna paste the function down here. I guess I can paste it right here. Okay, nice. So this is just a basic mathematical sigmoid function, and we're just gonna apply this to our output. So like this, nice. All right, so this is gonna calculate the output of every single node. Now, just for the time being, I'm also gonna set the desired values of every node equal to the values. This is gonna come handy later when we actually do the training, but for now, just shrug it off. Okay, so we calculated the values of every node, and now we just need to return the output, so we can just do return, and we actually want the last layer, so we can just do values.length minus 1. Great. So now we can give this network any inputs we want, and it's gonna return us some outputs. Now, naturally, since we are not doing any training, and we are initializing our weights randomly, the outputs that we get back are gonna be utter garbage. So now let's actually do the training process. One thing I want to note though, and you may have noticed, that when I pasted the sigmoid function, I also pasted this hard sigmoid function, Basically, what this is actually an approximation of this function right here. So this function right here will deal similar results as the normal sigmoid, but it's less resource intensive. So it doesn't have to do exponential, all of that stuff. So if you're planning on doing a big project with, a really complicated network or a lot of iterations, I'd suggest to use the hard sigmoid instead of the normal sigmoid. This one is a little bit less precise, but it's actually easier to compute. But in our case, we are not gonna need it, so I'm just gonna keep it here, but, you know, it just to show. We're gonna use the normal sigmoid. Alright, so this is the pseudocode for this function. Naturally, we're not gonna get only one training input, but we're gonna get a lot of them. This is why it is a two-vectored array, or a two-dimensional array. So we're gonna iterate over every training input. We're gonna test our network, so we're basically gonna apply this function right here, so we get the outputs given the inputs, and then we're gonna set the correct or desired outputs that we are gonna know as a parameter. So remember, this is our training data, so we already know the wanted result. In the analogy I was doing in the last video, we already know if the brick is red or blue, and we know their sizes, so we are using this data to train our network. So we're just gonna give this information to our network, and we're gonna set it to the desired values. So this is basically why this variable exists. Alright, and then we're gonna do what is called backpropagation, and it's what I was attempting to explain in the last episode. Basically, we will iterate over every node backwards, and we're gonna try to calculate how much the weights and biases of that node should change in order to get the correct outputs. And also we're gonna calculate and store the correct and desired values of the previous layer, so that when we iterate backwards once again, we can do the same procedure until we reach the inputs. And once all of this is done, we can actually apply those changes by iterating over everything once again. Alright, let's begin. Alright, so we are iterating over every training input. We are gonna calculate the output, so we're gonna test for the current training input, which is gonna be training input I, and we're gonna calculate an output, which we're gonna call like this. Actually, we don't need the output, because it's changing already the values of the different arrays, so we don't actually need to store this. Okay, so now actually let's set the desired outputs of our network. So we're gonna iterate over the last layer, which is gonna be desired values, and then desired values dot length minus 1, and we're gonna set the desired values j equal to the training outputs, not inputs, but outputs of this iteration, the training outputs of this data, which is gonna be I, and then j, because we want this output. Oh, right, and I did this to be dot length, of course. Okay, and here it must iterate only on this layer, so it has to be like this. So basically, we are setting the desired values for the outputs. Okay, awesome, so now that our network knows those, we can actually start backpropagating. So this is a backwards loop that will start from the last layer and will go all the way to the first hidden layer. We don't actually need to go to the inputs, because we actually cannot modify the inputs, so that it makes no sense. So we're actually iterating over every single layer backwards, so this one, except the inputs. Okay, now let's iterate over every node. Alright, and now let's calculate how much the bias has to change on this node in order to get the correct training outputs. Alright, in order to make this happen, we actually need to have the derivative of the sigmoid function, which is actually this function right here. I'm gonna paste it down here. It's not really complicated, it's just the derivative of the sigmoid function. And now I'm not gonna actually get into the details on why this formula will get us the bias smudge, so how much we need to change our bias in order to get the correct training outputs that we want. If you're interested in why that works and actually what's the math behind it, I have a good video in the description made by 3Blue1Brown. It's actually an entire series that guides you through the math and actually makes you understand why this works. So we take the derivative of the values of the current node and we multiply that by the cost. Basically, the cost is how much our value is different from the value that we want. Because of course, if our value is really close to the value that we want, then we are not gonna need to change the bias that much. But if our value is really far from the value we desire, then we're gonna have to change the bias much more. And the derivative actually tells us kinda in which direction we need to change our values, because the derivative is actually the slope of our function. But I'm not gonna get into the math in this video. Alright, so now that we calculated the bias smudge of a given node, let's say that the given node is this one, okay, we are calculating... Oh, whoops, I didn't want to do that. Okay, we are calculating the bias smudge of this node. Now we need to calculate the weight smudge of every connection that goes to this node. So in our case, it's gonna be this connection right here, and this connection right here. Okay, so we need to iterate once again. I know, a lot of iterators. But this time we actually need to iterate over the previous layer, so minus one, because we need to get the connections that start from this layer, these two. Alright, great, and for every one of these connections we can calculate the weight smudge. And this is the formula for the weight smudge. Basically it's the same as the one for the bias smudge, but we actually need to multiply that by the node, or the value of the node this connection originates from. So it's gonna be the bias smudge that we calculated before, this one, multiplied by the value of this node. This is gonna give us the weight smudge of, let me mark this in blue, of this connection. Alright, and the last thing we need to calculate, we calculated the bias smudge, we calculated the weight smudge, naturally this is gonna happen for every single connection, we actually need to calculate the value smudge, or the desired value, that we want for the layer before, so we can keep on propagating backwards. Now this is not a good example because this layer is already the inputs layer, but let's pretend we are right here, we calculated the bias smudge of this node, we calculated the weight smudge of all of these connections that go to this node, and now we're gonna calculate the value smudge of every single one of these nodes right here. So then, knowing the correct values of these nodes, we can actually do the same exact operation backwards. So we can calculate, for example, the bias smudge of this node, right here, and then calculate the weight smudge of every single connections that go to this node. So then we're gonna reach, finally, our inputs. Okay, and the value smudge, or the correct value of a given node, is the bias smudge that we calculated for this node already, multiplied by the weight of the connection. As I said, I'm not gonna go through the maths, but basically this is what it does. Alright, so now we have the bias smudge, the weight smudge, and the value smudge. Great. Let's actually store them somewhere. So we're gonna store the bias smudge in the biases smudges, jk, okay, and we're gonna make it plus equal to the bias smudge. So remember, this is not the bias we want, but this is by how much we need to change the bias we currently have in order to get a better one. So this is why I'm doing plus equal right here. Okay, we're gonna do the same thing for the weight smudge. In this case, we're gonna be j minus 1 because we are on the layer before, kl. This is gonna be equal or plus equal to the weight smudge we just calculated. And finally, the desired values is gonna be plus equal to the value smudge. Now, keep in mind, we initialized, when we test our network right here, we initialized our desired values to our actual values. So when we do plus equal right here, we are smudging a little bit the values we already calculated. So we can get the correct one and we can keep iterating backwards. This is basically the basic of backpropagation. So now, after we did all of this procedure for every node in a layer, and after we did all of this procedure for every layer except the input one, because we don't need to do it for the input layer, all of these wonderful weight smudges and bias smudges, we actually need to apply them to our network so that our network learns. Okay, we actually need to do this last operation outside of this iterator right here, because we need to do this only after we finish calculating the smudges for every single one of our training inputs. Okay, so outside of here, I'm actually just gonna paste the code and then explain it. Basically, we are iterating over every layer again. This time it actually doesn't matter if it's backwards or not. And we're actually not iterating over the input layer, because we don't need to. Now we are iterating over every node, and in every node we are actually adding up the bias, or the bias smudge. Now you can see this little part is commented right here. We're gonna get into this for just a moment. As of right now, just pretend it isn't there. Actually, I just removed all of the comments so you don't have any problems. Now, after we applied our bias smudge to the biases, we can set the bias smudge back to zero so that it's fully reset And when we train our network again, you know, we're not gonna have any problem. We're not gonna have any leftovers. Okay, and then we iterate again over every connection, or over every connection which is connected to this node. So if we are looking at this node right here, we are then, after we applied the bias, we are then gonna look at every single connection right here. I'm really good at end writing. So as you can see, these three weights are gonna be equal to their corresponding weights smudge. And also we're gonna reset the weights smudge, just like how we reset the bias smudge. Finally, we need to also reset the desired values. Great, and with this, we are done. This is actually training. This is actually gonna give us a correct result. Now, this works, okay? And it's actually pretty cool that it works, and it, you know, for everyone that doesn't know everything that is behind it, it kinda sort of looks like magic. But there are some sort of things, or hyperparameters, that we can assign to this network to help him train, to help him work. And I'm not gonna discuss about them so much in this episode, maybe it's gonna be like something that we do in further episodes. But right now, I just wanna talk about two hyperparameters, which are the weight decay and the learning rate. Now, these two are super important, and actually adjusting them correctly are gonna make your network train much faster and with much more accuracy. Now, you may say, Nico, how can I adjust these parameters, and what do these parameters even do? Now, there are a lot of guidelines that tell you how to adjust this, and I will probably link some in the description, but mostly, you kinda have to try it out and see how it goes. I mean, it really depends on your problem. So once you actually implement your neural network for something, and if you see that, you know, it's not working out and it's not as fast as you want it to be, you can just tweak a little bit these values right here, and your network might improve, or might be even worse. You kinda have to play around with them. So the learning rate determines how much of the smudges we calculated are actually gonna get set to the weights and the biases. So instead of adding the entire bias smudge to a bias, we just give it a percentage of it, so maybe just 50%. And this percentage is the learning rate. So basically it's a number that goes from 0 to 1. And basically the same thing can be done with the weight smudge. The reason why you might want a learning rate is because if there is none, then your network will just keep on going and smudging between a lot of different biases and weights, and maybe it will actually never converge on a solution. It will always try to train, but it will not get better. It will just, you know, shuffle around and randomize itself without ever converging. Also, a slower learning rate may actually help the network to find better solution instead of just, you know, going around blindly and finding the mediocre solution, which is not gonna be the best one, and just getting stuck on that one. In my case though, I actually managed to make everything work fine with a learning rate of 1, which is basically a non-existent learning rate. But I have learned you could actually start from a learning rate of even 0.5, or anything, but it really depends on your problem. Many people also have a dynamic learning rate, meaning that at the beginning it's pretty high, and then it gets lower and lower and lower, because you actually expect your network to converge, and so to not learn as much. But yeah, a lot of guidelines you can actually check out. For now, I'm just gonna leave this be at 1. And then another thing is the weight decay. Basically, every single training session, our biases and our weights kinda go down a little, kinda decay, and the rate of the decay is influenced by this variable. So the bigger this variable is, that goes from 0 to 1, the bigger the decay there is. And naturally you need to keep this variable really low. For example, if the variable is 1, then we're just setting our biases all to 0, which is not what we want. The reason why we may want a weight decay is because sometimes we can get a weight which is really, really, really influential to our network, so a value which is really high, and the entire network will only be dependent on that weight, and that is not what we want. So just to make the network more dynamic and not to get it stuck on these scenarios, we are slowly decreasing the weights, and we are hoping that when the network trains, it will actually compensate for that. And it will not compensate for that if that weight is not supposed to be that high. So this is gonna, you know, kinda normalize all of the weights between some boundaries. But yeah, there are a bunch of really awesome people that, you know, talked a bunch on all of these different hyperparameters, and they're actually really fun to look at. So, you know, you could actually go see them by yourself. There are actually many more that you can adjust and add to the network, which will kinda tweak it and make it better. Anyway, this is all I wanted to show for today. Now, before leaving, you could actually be confused on how I made all of this, so how I'm actually giving my network, you know, all of these different inputs and, you know, actually training it. So I'm just gonna show you the code for this real quick. So this is some code in C# Unity. And as you can see, every time I click with my mouse, I will create a new game object. So as you can see, I will spawn a new flower. And then when I want to train the network, this code can go away. When I want to train the network, which is like always in this scenario, I'm training it every single tick. I'm gonna train it for a number of iterations, which is basically this slider right here. This speed represents the iterations I'm training it for. And the inputs are gonna be all of the flowers that I placed. So all of the positions of this game object that I just created, and the output will be whether the game object I created is red or blue. So if it's red, the output will be 0, 1, if it's blue, it's gonna be 1, 0, meaning the probability of it being red is 0, the probability of it being blue is 1, so it's 100%. And I'm basically gonna do this for x iterations. And then one last thing, I can actually adjust from here how complex my network is. And the way this works is actually this function right here, change network. And basically what it's doing is it's initializing a new network. It should actually be called backpropagation neural network, but you know, it's using this class, which is basically the same. And it's initializing it with the structure I gave him. And naturally the structure will always be 2, because there are always 2 inputs, the width and the height. And there are always 2 outputs, which is the color red and the color blue. But the and there is always 1 hidden layer, but what actually changes is how many nodes that hidden layer has, and this is basically what this slider controls. So as you can see, now our network has 8 hidden nodes, so right here this value will be 8. And this is basically all you need to know in order to implement this class that we created right here. So you can go in the description and check out on GitHub this little class right here that I've implemented. I'm not gonna actually show you all of this other boilerplate code, and the reason for that is that it's really spaghetti, there is a lot of weird stuff going on, I'm not even sure why, and also I wasn't using this exact network, but I was using like a more complicated one, that was really similar, but just had a little bit of a different structure, as you can see. It was a little bit more complicated. Maybe in the future though, I will show you how I'm graphing the network, but it's, you know, pretty self-explanatory once you know actually how to build the network. So you can check all of this stuff out in the description. Thank you ever so much for watching till the very end. If you really enjoyed this content, you know, you actually learned something new, or you even have a suggestion, you can leave a like, subscribe and hit the bell. And for the last thing, if you have a suggestion, you can actually leave a comment and I can do another episode on that. Honestly, I'm really excited about this series and I feel like I can talk about so much stuff on machine learning, and I feel like it's gonna be pretty exciting. So you can look forward to more episodes. Hope you really enjoyed this video, it was really amazing to make, and I'm gonna see you guys in the next one. See ya!